Ultimately, Jane Austen's novel is a novel of education. Her heroine, Catherine, has to learn to understand her world and her position in her world correctly. Unlike Emma in the novel Emma, or Elizabeth Bennet in Pride and Prejudice, both of whom have to learn something about themselves and their relationship to others, Catherine actually has to understand something about her world and how to read her world. And in order to read one's world correctly, one has to understand contexts. One of the reasons that irony is so important in the novel, and one of the reasons that irony works at all, is that one has to be able to understand the context of a statement in order to understand the statement correctly. One has to be able to look at the circumstances, sort of the totality of experience within which a statement is made, and understand that its immediate surface meaning is not the only possible way to read it, and to be able to apply the correct context in order to understand the statement correctly. And the problem with Catherine is that she doesn't understand contexts. She doesn't understand the situations within which she is involved well enough to fully read what is going on in that circumstance. And so, in order to perceive her world correctly, Catherine has to be able to learn the circumstances, the contexts. One way of looking at this is a paradigm or a perceptual framework. And Catherine has to learn the perceptual frameworks within which the experience she perceives have meaning. And this novel is going to be an education about those perceptual frameworks. Now, it's clear in the novel that Austen's narrator, although she makes fun of Catherine for misapplying the paradigms of Gothic novels, it's not the problem of Gothic novels themselves. Gothic novels are perfectly fine. Henry reads and enjoys Gothic novels. The problem is mistaking Gothic novels for reality. The problem here is not being able to correctly apply the Gothic novel framework to its appropriate setting. To understand that it is an entertaining framework that's completely appropriate to a novel, but it's not a perceptual model that one should use to read reality. And we'll look at, on the one hand, the narrator's endorsement of Gothic novels as a legitimate form of entertainment, but at the same time, her ironic willingness to make fun of Catherine for misapplying that framework as Catherine learns to read her world correctly. The very first line of Jane Austen's novel Pride and Prejudice begins, "It is a truth universally acknowledged that a single man in possession of a good fortune must be in want of a wife." Of course, the unwritten corollary to that law is that a mother who has several unmarried daughters is desperately in search of potential husbands, especially those with fortune. And of course, this is true in Pride and Prejudice, as Mrs. Bennet has several unmarried daughters who have no fortune of their own, and so one of the main goals of her life is to try to procure husbands for her daughters, even husbands who aren't necessarily the most desirable. Mrs. Thorpe is in a similar circumstance. And one of the things that one must keep in mind, of course, is the context of this. We're in Bath. Bath is a fashionable watering hole where people go ostensibly to take the waters and to regain their health or for a vacation or relaxation. But it's also a place where one might go meet unmarried men who are in search of wives, or where a young man might go to find a wife. And Mrs. Thorpe is clearly here during the season shopping for a husband for her daughter Isabella. And this is implicit at the end of chapter 4 on page 16 when we're told that Mrs. Thorpe was a widow and not a very rich one. She was a good-humored, well-meaning woman and a very indulgent mother. Her eldest daughter had great personal beauty, and the younger ones, by pretending to be as handsome as their sister, imitating her air and dressing in the same style, did very well. Well, one of the things that's implicit here is that because she's not a very rich one, she isn't going to be able to attract a husband to her daughters by their wealth, especially in a fashionable place like this. And so their main goal in coming to a place like this is to find rich husbands who would be attracted by their beauty, which they will need because they need someone who's able to support them. In our current society, this sounds like gold digging and is frowned upon. But in Jane Austen's time, it's actually a very practical necessity because a young woman has no means of supporting herself, as Mary Wollstonecraft observes in A Vindication of the Rights of Woman, other than marrying well, and young women are educated for the purposes of attracting a husband. They're educated in the quote-unquote feminine wiles and the skills of attracting a man, playing well, drawing well, fashionable conversation, cultivating their beauty in order to attract a husband, according to Mary Wollstonecraft, because this is the only means they have of survival. Women are not allowed to own property in their own right unless they're extremely lucky and are widowed, meaning that their husband dies, leaving them with control of their own property. Other than that, women, unless they have wealth on their own, are bound to marry in order to support themselves. As Charlotte tells Elizabeth in Pride and Prejudice, she must marry because she is already becoming a drain on her parents, and she has no other prospects. And once her parents die, she is condemned to poverty. So marrying well is her only resort. So it's not necessarily just gold digging. It's actually a survival mechanism at this point for a young woman, finding a husband who can support her. And so Mrs. Thorpe is here to find husbands for her daughters. Now, we understand that Isabella Thorpe has already managed to attract what she thinks is a good potential husband, someone who will be able to support her, and who also turns out to be Catherine's brother, James. And we'll find out later how that works out for Isabella, James, and for Catherine. But this is a context that Catherine needs to be able to read in order to understand Isabella and Isabella's behavior, and her behavior particularly in the social circumstances of Bath. Unlike Catherine, Isabella is rather worldly and understands the mechanisms of social behavior, of which Catherine is, fortunately, ignorant, because what it turns Isabella into is arch and artificial. But it becomes quite clear in the relationship between Catherine and Isabella that Isabella has certain expectations that Catherine doesn't understand she's supposed to meet as the confidant of a young woman. In chapter 5, at the top of page 18, Catherine and Isabella are exchanging confidences about their romantic involvements. And Catherine has already met Henry Tilney and is interested in him, although he, for some reason, seems to have disappeared from Bath at this point. And of course, Catherine must share her interest in Henry with her new friend, Isabella. And by the way, friendship here is indicated by the fact that Catherine and Isabella have already lapsed into calling each other by their first names. Calling one by one's first name in Regency and Victorian society is a sign of familiarity, of very close relationship. Husbands and wives in public don't even call themselves by their first names. They call each other by Mr. and Mrs., as you see in this novel. And so when Catherine and Isabella are calling each other by their first names, it's a symbol that they have gained enough intimacy, or at least the appearance of intimacy, in order to exchange personal information. Catherine has told Isabella about Henry, about Mr. Tilney at this point, and Isabella's response is, she liked him better for being a clergyman, for she must confess herself very partial to the profession, and something like a sigh escaped her as she said it. Perhaps Catherine was wrong in not demanding the cause of that gentle emotion, but she was not experienced enough of the finesse of love or the duties of friendship to know when a delicate raillery was properly called for or when confidence should be forced. What this means is that Isabella is fishing for a question. Isabella has her own love interest, and she wants Catherine to ask her about it, and the sigh is intended to be a hint to mean, I too am in love, but I can't speak of it because it's not ladylike. And Catherine at this point is supposed to say, oh dear Isabella, do tell me, do you have your own love interest? But of course, Catherine, unaware of the duties of friendship or the finesse of love, and doesn't catch the hint, and so doesn't ask Isabella. Of course, it's because Catherine is a young ingenue. She's naive. She doesn't know what's going on here. But later on, Isabella will quite hilariously accuse Catherine of being the one who's being duplicitous and arch and refusing to tell personal information. Catherine's inability to understand Isabella and to catch Isabella's broadly dropped hints persist throughout their relationship. And Catherine, in fact, doesn't fully understand Isabella until almost the end of the novel, at which point Catherine realizes that Isabella was not the person she thought she was. Later on page 21, In the middle of a conversation about their reading habits, Isabella drops another broad hint. She says, "Oh, I must tell you that just after we parted yesterday, I saw a young man looking at you so earnestly. I am sure he is in love with you." Catherine colored and disclaimed again. Isabella laughed. "It is very true upon my honor, but I see how it is. You are indifferent to everybody's admiration except that of one gentleman who shall be nameless. Nay, I cannot blame you," speaking more seriously. "Your feelings are easily understood, where the heart is really attached. I know very well how little one can be pleased with the attention of anybody else. Everything is so insipid, so uninteresting, that does not relate to the beloved object. I can perfectly comprehend your feelings." And Isabella is, of course, dropping the hint that I, too, have a deep attachment, and it's making life insipid for me here when my beloved is away. And Catherine is supposed to respond to this hint, but of course, Catherine doesn't. She doesn't pick up on it. Later on down, at the bottom of page 22, Isabella tries again, once again turning the attention to young men and to love, and asks her, "What's your favorite complexion in a man? Do you like them best dark or fair?" And Catherine, of course, answers honestly, "I hardly know. I have never thought much about it. Something between both, I think. Brown, not fair, and not very dark." "Very well, Catherine, that is exactly he. I have forgot your description of Mr. Tilney, a brown skin with dark eyes and rather dark hair." And of course, what Isabella is hinting at is that Catherine is thinking only of my beloved, but Catherine is just sort of answering honestly, not having thought about it. She says, "Oh, I guess this is what I like." Well, of course, then Isabella drops a hint. "Well, my taste is different. I prefer light eyes. And as to complexion, do you know, I like a sallow better than any other. You must not betray me if you should ever meet with one of your acquaintance answering that description." And of course, the one of your acquaintance that Isabella is specifically referring to and has been implicitly describing is Catherine's own brother, James. But of course, Catherine misses this. "Betray you? What do you mean? Nay, do not distress me. I believe I have said too much. Let us drop the subject." What Catherine doesn't understand is that Isabella has a hidden agenda that is constantly going on underneath what appears to be her explicit or overt motivations. And this opposition between what Isabella says she wants and what Isabella is actually doing comes up quite clearly just a few sentences later. "For heaven's sake, let us move away from this end of the room. Do you know there are two odious young men who have been staring at me this half hour? They really put me quite out of countenance. Let us go and look at the arrivals. They will hardly follow us there." And away they walk to the book. The book would be the book of the new arrivals who write their name in the book, sort of like a log of who's there so you can go see if your friends have arrived. And while Isabella examined the names, it was Catherine's employment to watch the proceedings of these alarming young men. "They are not coming this way, are they? I hope they are not so impertinent as to follow us. Pray let me know if they are coming. I am determined I will not look up." In a few moments, Catherine, with unaffected pleasure, assured her that she need not be longer uneasy, as the gentleman had just left the pump room. "And which way are they gone?" said Isabella, turning hastily round. "One was a very good-looking young man. They went toward the churchyard. Well, I am amazingly glad I have got rid of them. And now, what say you to going to Edgar's buildings with me and looking at my new hat? You said you should like to see it." Catherine readily agreed, only she added, "Perhaps we may overtake the two young men." "Oh, never mind that. If we make haste, we shall pass by them presently, and I am dying to show you my hat." "But if we wait only a few minutes, there will be no danger of our seeing them at all." "I shall not pay them any such compliment, I assure you. I have no notion of treating men with such respect. That is the way to spoil them." Catherine had nothing to oppose against such reasoning, and therefore, to show the independence of Miss Thorpe and her resolution of humbling the sex, they set off immediately as fast as they could walk in pursuit of the two young men. And so, of course, Isabella is pretending to find the two young men's attention objectionable and is trying to get away from them, but she's actually moving away from them to see if they're actually paying attention to her, and when it turns out they leave, she then goes off chasing them down because, of course, she was interested in them, and Catherine doesn't pick up on this. So Catherine is unable to read the circumstances or the behavior of the people around her. And by the way, later on page 25, when they actually do catch up the two young men who they had been chasing, we get this passage. "So pure and uncoquettish were her feelings that, though they overtook and passed the two offending young men in Milsom Street, she was so far from seeking to attract their notion that she looked back at them only three times." one of the most entertaining examples of Catherine's inability to read context correctly comes in chapter 15 on page 83 in our edition, during which John Thorpe, inspired by his sister's apparent success with Catherine's brother James, makes a fairly broad hint that he wants to propose to Catherine himself. And so John Thorpe is getting ready to go back to London because he wants to head back for a social event. And as he's taking his leave of Catherine, starts to hint around at his desire to propose marriage to her. And Catherine just completely misses the point, responding in a noncommittal way, which John sees as assent to his implied proposal. So it starts off right here. "Shall you not be late at Devizes?" said Catherine. He made no answer, but after a minute's silence burst out with, "A famous good thing, this marrying scheme, upon my soul. A clever fancy of Morland's and Bell's. What do you think of it, Miss Morland? I say it is no bad notion." Bell, of course, is Isabella. "I'm sure I think it is a very good one." What Catherine is saying here is, I think that James marrying Isabella is a very good idea. What John is talking about is his marrying Catherine. "Do you? That's honest, by heavens. I'm glad that you're no enemy to matrimony, however. Did you ever hear the old song, 'Going to one wedding brings on another'? I say, you will come to Belle's wedding, I hope." So, of course, the context of this is the song, "Going to one wedding brings on another." And so, if she will come to Belle's wedding, that means that she will be interested in engaging in her own matrimonial pursuits. "Yes, I have promised your sister to be with her, if possible." And then, you know, twisting himself about and forcing a foolish laugh, "I say, then, you know, we may try the truth of this same old song." We, meaning he and Catherine, will try the truth of the song about bringing on another wedding. "May we? But I never sing." "Well, I wish you a good journey. I dine with Miss Tilney today and now must be going home." And Catherine completely misreads this. She thinks "we may try this truth of the same old song" means we'll try singing the song. But of course, that's not what John meant. "Nay, but there is no such confounded hurry. Who knows when we may be together again? Not but that I shall be down again by the end of a fortnight, and a devilish long fortnight it will appear to me," of course, because he will be separated from Catherine is his implied meaning. "Then why do you stay away so long?" replied Catherine, finding that he waited for an answer. So he is hinting that he wants to come back to be with her, and waiting to see how she responds. And she's being polite and asking, "Then if it seems like it's going to be a long time to be away, why are you going to be away so long?" And he sees this as encouragement. "That is kind of you, however, good kind and good nature. I shall not forget it in a hurry, but you have more good nature and all that than anybody living, I believe. A monstrous deal of good nature. And it is not only good nature, but you have so much of everything. And then you have such, upon my soul, I do not know anybody like you." Of course, this is his profession of love. "Oh dear, there are a great many people like me, I dare say, only a great deal better. Good morning to you. But I say, Miss Morland, I shall come and pay my respects at Fullerton before it is long, if not disagreeable." In other words, Fullerton is where her parents live. He is going to go visit her parents. He's going to go visit her father to ask for her hand in marriage. "Pray do. My father and mother will be very glad to see you." John Thorpe is James Morland's good friend and the brother of James's fiancée. So, of course, they're going to be happy to see him as a family friend and a guest of the family. But from Thorpe's perspective, Isabella has just encouraged him to visit her father to ask for her hand in marriage. "And I hope, Miss Morland, you will not be sorry to see me." "Oh dear, not at all. There are very few people I am sorry to see. Company is always cheerful," and her response is for a noncommittal. "Of course not. I'm always happy to see people." "That is just my way of thinking. Give me but a little cheerful company. Let me only have the company of people I love. Let me only be where I like and with whom I like, and the devil take the rest, say I. And I am heartily glad to hear you say the same. But I have a notion, Miss Morland, you and I think pretty much alike on most matters." "Perhaps we may, but it's more than I ever thought of. And as to most matters, to say the truth, there are not many that I know my own mind about." Thorpe is, in his perspective, making mad love to her, proposing marriage. And Catherine is being polite and just trying to get out of the conversation because she wants to go meet Miss Tilney. And everything she says, because she's not aware of the context, ends up encouraging John Thorpe. And what John says next pretty much seals the deal here. "My notion of things is simple enough. Let me only have a girl I like, say I, with a comfortable house over my head, and what care I for the rest? Fortune is nothing. I am sure of a good income of my own. If she had not a penny, why, so much the better." Of course, he understands now, because of the relationship between James and his sister, that Catherine's parents don't have a tremendous amount of money to give. In fact, he's actually misunderstood and believes them to be poorer than they really are. And so he's saying, I would be happy to take you even if you had no fortune. And she says, very true. I think like you there, if there is a good fortune on one side, there can be no occasion for any on the other, no matter which has it, so that there is enough. I hate the idea of one great fortune looking out for another. And to marry for money, I think the wickedest thing in existence. Good day. We shall be glad to see you at Fullerton whenever it is convenient. John hears Catherine saying, well, I'm glad that you like me regardless of the fact that I don't have a lot of money. When you come to Fullerton and ask for my hand, we shall be glad to see you. And what Catherine is actually saying is, sure, I agree with you. There's no reason for people who are wealthy to marry each other. If they like each other, enough money to survive on is plenty. And you're welcome to come visit my parents whenever you feel like it. That's not what John hears. And away she went. It was not in the power of all his gallantry to detain her longer. With such news to communicate and such a visit to prepare for, her departure was not to be delayed by anything in his nature to urge. And she hurried away, leaving him to an undivided consciousness of his own happy address and her explicit encouragement. So this is a good example of how Catherine's inability to read context mires her in danger that she doesn't even recognize, which will lead us, of course, to the end of the novel and her visit to Northanger Abbey. But before we go on to the end of the novel and look at the final act at Northanger Abbey, we need to go back to an earlier scene in the novel, which is very important for two reasons. First, it helps expose the relationship between perceptual frameworks and understanding. We see three different people having a conversation in which each person is applying a different framework, and therefore there is a misunderstanding between them about what they're discussing. And then also it shows Catherine's beginning to understand the importance of perceptual frameworks and being able to see. And in this case, it's actually a perceptual framework guiding the understanding of the landscape. Catherine's perception of the landscape is based upon her natural and naive understanding of what appearances are, whereas Henry and Eleanor are looking at the landscape through the perspective of someone who's been trained in landscape art, and they see it artistically, which shifts their understanding of what they're seeing. It's not really necessarily that one way of seeing is better than another way of seeing, but it does show that different frameworks imply different understandings of the scene. We are in chapter 14 on page 70 and 71. What has gone on at this particular point in the novel is that Catherine and Eleanor and Henry were supposed to go out for a drive, and James, John, and Isabella tricked her into thinking that Henry and Eleanor had canceled the trip so she would go with them. Because, of course, Isabella can't go on a ride with two men with no other woman present to chaperone. However, it turns out that that was a trick. Henry and Eleanor had expected her to go along. Isabella was embarrassed and ended up apologizing, which worked out to her advantage, actually, in the long run. But now she's going to finally fulfill this drive with Henry and Eleanor. The next morning was fair, and Catherine almost expected another attack from the assembled party. The assembled party would be James, John, and Isabella. With Mr. Allen to support her, she felt no dread of the event, but she would gladly be spared a contest where victory itself was painful, and was heartily rejoiced, therefore, at neither seeing nor hearing anything of them. The Tilneys called for her at the appointed time, with no new difficulty arising, no sudden recollection, no unexpected summons, no impertinent intrusion to disconcert their measures. My heroine was most unnaturally able to fulfill her engagement, though it was made with the hero himself. And there again is the ironic commentary on the Gothic expectation. So the heroine gets to do what she wants without some strange event interrupting. They determined on walking around Beechen Cliff, that noble hill whose beautiful verdure and hanging coppice render it so striking an object from almost every opening in Bath. I never look at it, said Catherine, as they walked along the side of the river, without thinking of the south of France. You have been abroad then? Said Henry, a little surprised. And he's surprised because a young woman of 15, 16, would probably not have had much opportunity to travel yet. A young, middle-class woman would probably travel to the continent when she was of a mature age and perhaps when she was married. No, I only mean what I have read about. It always puts me in mind of the country that Emily and her father traveled through in The Mysteries of Udolpho. So, once again, Catherine's framework for perception is what she's read about, and she believes that this is the kind of country that would be experienced by the heroine and her father in The Mysteries of Udolpho. But then she introduces the question of novel reading. But you never read novels, I dare say. Why not? Because they are not clever enough for you. Gentlemen read better books. And Henry, of course, immediately corrects her perception about his enjoyment of novels. The person, being it a gentleman or a lady, who has not pleasure in a good novel must be intolerably stupid. And of course, John Thorpe is intolerably stupid and does not read novels. I have read all of Mrs. Radcliffe's works, and most of them with great pleasure. The Mysteries of Udolpho, when I had once begun it, I could not lay down again. I remember finishing it in 2 days, my hair standing on end the whole time. Yes, added Miss Tilney, and I remember that you undertook to read it aloud to me, and that when I was called away for only 5 minutes to answer a note, instead of waiting for me, you took the volume into the Hermitage Walk, and I was obliged to stay till you had finished it. In other words, I was obliged to wait until you had finished it before I could finish it. Thank you, Eleanor, a most honorable testimony. And of course, Henry is being sarcastic here. You see, Miss Morland, the injustice of your suspicions. Here was I, in my eagerness to get on, refusing to wait only 5 minutes for my sister, breaking the promise I had made of reading it aloud, and keeping her in suspense at a most interesting part by running away with a volume, which you are to observe was her own, particularly her own. I am proud when I reflect on it, and I think it must establish me in your good opinion. This is ironic, paying attention to irony. Eleanor has just accused him of doing something selfish, and he's turning it around and showing that this is a testament to his devotion to novel reading, which must establish him as a true devotee of the novel and gain Catherine's good opinion, even though it actually just shows that he's been a jerk to his sister. I'm glad to hear it indeed, and now I shall never be ashamed of liking Udolpho myself. But I really thought before young men despised novels amazingly. And this introduces a section in which Henry somewhat pedantically emphasizes his education by making fun of Catherine's use of language, after pointing out that he knows far more about the Gothic novel than Catherine could. There is an interesting discussion of gender politics at this point, since Henry is claiming expertise in an area that is supposed to be particularly feminine, the novel. Catherine herself identifies novel reading as a feminine exercise, something that men, with their more serious interests and pursuits, would not engage in. However, we don't have time at this point to discuss the gender politics of novels and novel reading. But I do encourage you to pay attention to that aspect of the novel, and it might perhaps be a good topic for a paper. But now really, do you not think Udolpho the nicest book in the world? The nicest, by which I suppose you mean the neatest. That must depend upon the binding. And now Henry, of course, is going to apply another framework. He's brought up the fact that he is an Oxford-educated man, and she is a young woman, and now he's going to be making fun of her use of nice. Nice now, of course, means pleasant. Someone is nice. But back then, what nice meant was either a fine distinction. Someone was making nice distinctions, distinguishing between very subtle characteristics, or nice meant neat, as in well-arranged. The nicest, by which I suppose you mean the neatest. That must depend upon the binding. And of course, he's talking about the physical appearance of the book instead of its content. Henry, said Miss Tilney, you are very impertinent. Miss Morland, he is treating you exactly as he does his sister. He is forever finding fault with me for some incorrectness of language, and now he is taking the same liberty with you. The word nicest, as you used it, did not suit him, and you had better change it as soon as you can, or we shall be overpowered with Johnson and Blair all the rest of the way. Johnson and Blair, famous dictionary authors. I am sure, cried Catherine, I did not mean to say anything wrong, but it is a nice book, and why should I not call it so? Very true, said Henry, and this is a very nice day, and we are taking a very nice walk, and you are two very nice young ladies. Oh, it is a very nice word indeed, it does for everything. Originally, perhaps, it was applied only to express neatness, propriety, delicacy, or refinement. People were nice in their dress and their sentiments or their choice. But now every commendation on every subject is comprised in that one word. Well, in fact, cried his sister, it ought only to be applied to you without any commendation at all. You are more nice than wise. Come, Miss Morland, let us leave him to meditate over our faults in the utmost propriety of diction, while we praise Udolpho in whatever terms we like best. It is a most interesting work. You are fond of that kind of reading? And of course, Eleanor wittily turns the phrase against him, using the word nice to mean someone who is making overly fine distinctions, someone who is engaging in pedantry. So she is suggesting that by insisting on a limited use of the word nice and by criticizing Catherine for her use, he is simply being a pedant and a bore. Thus, it ought only to be applied to you without any commendation at all. You are more nice than wise. And now we move on to the next distinction that they make, which is the discussion about reading. You are fond of that kind of reading? To say the truth, I do not much like any other. Indeed, that is, I can read poetry and plays and things of that sort and do not dislike travels. But history, real solemn history, I cannot be interested in. Can you? Yes, I'm fond of history. I wish I were too. I read it a little as a duty, but it tells me nothing that does not either vex or weary me. The quarrels of popes and kings with wars or pestilences in every page. The men are all so good for nothing and hardly any women at all. It is very tiresome, and yet I often think it odd that it should be so dull, for such a great deal of it must be invention. The speeches that are put into the heroes' mouths, their thoughts and designs, the chief of all this must be invention, and invention is what delights me in other books. Historians, you think, said Miss Tilney, are not happy in their flights of fancy. They display imagination without raising interest. I am fond of history, and am very well contented to take the false with the true. In the principal facts, they have sources of intelligence and former histories and records, which may be as much depended on, I conclude, as anything that does not actually pass under one's own observation. And as for the little embellishments you speak of, they are embellishments, and I like them as such. If a speech be well drawn up, I read it with pleasure, by whomsoever it may be made, and probably with much greater, if the production of Mr. Hume or Mr. Robertson, than if the genuine words of Caractacus, Agricola, or Alfred the Great. You are fond of history, and so are Mr. Allen and my father, and I have two brothers who do not dislike it. So many instances within my small circle of friends is remarkable. At this rate, I shall not pity the writers of history any longer. If people like to read their books, it is all very well, but to be at so much trouble in filling great volumes, which, as I used to think, nobody would willingly ever look into, to be laboring only for the torment of little boys and girls, always struck me as a hard fate. And though I know it is all very right and necessary, I have often wondered at the person's courage that could sit down on purpose to do it. Okay, so let's go back up and look at this passage. Of course, Catherine is expressing her previously acknowledged, at the early part of the novel, preference for fanciful fiction over real solemn history. And Eleanor is explaining another way of looking at history, a way that makes it more interesting. But of course, both perceptions of history are accurate in their degree. Catherine points out that the men are all good for nothing and there are hardly any women at all, and much of it is dull,
which is surprising because most of it must be fiction anyway.
And in fact, that is a valid perspective. And women often tend to be left out of historical texts because the texts are written by men, for men, about men. And so this is a valid perspective. But of course, Eleanor offers her separate perspective, which is that it's as true as anything. The embellishments, well, you regard them as embellishments and enjoy them when they're happy and ignore them when they're not.
The assumption is that we're supposed to see Catherine's perspective as naive and uninformed, and Eleanor's perspective as a more educated perspective, valuing history as the more serious study. But I don't think it's that simple. The reality is that Catherine's charges about history are, to some extent, justified, that history is largely invention. And in fact, Eleanor admits that much of it is invention and the rest is a catalog of facts, which might be seen as dull. It really comes down to a difference in taste. The question is Catherine's perspective valid because she has not had the opportunity to study and understand history? And the next conversation with Henry about history as torment points out that perhaps we should be considering Catherine's perspective as well, that it really depends upon your framework in order to understand the evaluation. In fact, Catherine turns Henry's own objection to her use of torment against him when she points out a framework within which the study of history could indeed be regarded as torment and not simply a study.
But then that brings us to the next point. Catherine says she won't pity the writers of history anymore because she had always thought that their writing was primarily for the purpose of tormenting little boys and girls. And Henry takes that up in a rather witty way when he says, "That little boys and girls should be tormented," said Henry, "is what no one at all acquainted with human nature in a civilized state can deny. But in behalf of our most distinguished historians, I must observe that they might well be offended at being supposed to have no higher aim, and that by their method and style, they are perfectly qualified to torment readers of the most advanced reason and mature time of life. I use the verb to torment, as I observe to be your own method, instead of to instruct. supposing them now to be admitted as synonymous. So in other words, Henry is making fun of her by saying, well, historians are not only tormenting little boys and girls, they're tormenting adults too. But by torment, of course, I mean instruct, because you're using those two words synonymously, I assume. And Catherine turns it back on him. You think me foolish to call instruction a torment, but if you had been as much use as myself to hear poor little children first learning their letters and then learning a spell, if you had ever seen how stupid they can be for a whole morning together and how tired my poor mother is at the end of it, as I am in the habit of seeing it almost every day of my life at home, you would allow that to torment and to instruct might sometimes be used as synonymous words. And I think that's actually a clever response. She undoes his implied criticism of making to torment and to instruct synonymous. Henry goes on to say that reading is actually quite valuable and learning to read is worth it, and the pain of learning to read is worth it if one enjoys a whole lifetime of reading afterwards. Catherine agrees with this. Catherine assented in a very warm panegyric from her on that lady's merits closed the subject. The Tilneys were soon engaged in another on which she had nothing to say, and this turns out to be a very important passage in the novel. They were viewing the country with the eyes of persons accustomed to drawing and decided on its capability of being formed into pictures with all the eagerness of real taste. So these are the eyes of persons accustomed to drawing, and the implication is that people who are accustomed to drawing and used to seeing landscape, not in terms of simply raw landscape, but in terms of the subject matter for drawing, are going to see it essentially differently because they have a different framework. Here, Catherine was quite lost. She knew nothing of drawing, nothing of taste, and she listened to them with an attention which brought her little profit, for they talked in phrases which conveyed scarcely any idea to her. The little which she could understand, however, appeared to contradict the very few notions she had entertained on the matter before. It seemed as if a good view were no longer to be taken from the top of a high hill, and that a clear blue sky was no longer proof of a fine day. She was heartily ashamed of her ignorance, a misplaced shame. Where people wish to attach, they should always be ignorant. To come with a well-informed mind is to come with an inability of administering to the vanity of others, which a sensible person would always wish to avoid. A woman, especially, if she can have the misfortune of knowing anything, should conceal it as well as she can. So there are several things going on in this passage. There is the contrast between Catherine's naivete and Henry and Eleanor's knowledge of drawing. The notion of what taste is and how a taste must be cultivated. And that, of course, from Catherine's perspective, a good view is taken from a hill and a clear sky is evidence of a fine day, which is certainly true. I mean, those are reasons to see a day as fine. But from a drawing perspective, one would rather have a more interesting view of a landscape with a scene unfolding before them. And a broken, cloudy sky creates an effect called chiaroscuro, which is broken sunlight. So the clouds across the hills, creating shadows moving on the hills, is artistically more attractive. So that's one thing, this context of taste versus lack of taste. The second thing is the relationship between knowledge and gender. What Austen is arguing is that by being naive and innocent, she allows Henry to be knowledgeable, and that encourages his ego and makes her more attractive to him. So there's actually a gender issue in this as well. A woman, especially if she had the misfortune of knowing anything, should conceal it as well as she can. And that's a deeply ironic comment because it is both a commentary on the relationship between Henry and Catherine, but it's also, as a woman author, obviously a educated, knowledgeable woman author, she's sarcastically pointing out how knowledge in women is regarded. The advantages of natural folly in A Beautiful Girl have already been set forth by the capital pen of a sister author, and to her treatment of the subject I will only add, in justice to men, that though to the larger and more trifling part of the sex, imbecility in females is a great enhancement of their personal charms, there is a portion of them too reasonable and well-informed themselves to desire anything more in woman than ignorance. But Catherine did not know her own advantages, did not know that a good-looking girl with an affectionate heart and a very ignorant mind cannot fail of attracting a very young man, unless the circumstances are particularly untoward. In the present instance, she confessed and lamented her want of knowledge, declared that she would give anything in the world to be able to draw, and a lecture on the picturesque immediately followed, in which his instructions were so clear that she soon began to see beauty in everything admired by him, and her attention was so earnest that he became perfectly satisfied of her having a great deal of natural taste. In other words, everything he admires,
she likes because he admires it because she likes him. And every time she agrees with him, it flatters his ego, which makes him like her more. So there's a gender politics issue hiding in the background here. He talked of foregrounds, distances, and second distances, side screens and perspective, lights and shades. And Catherine was so hopeful a scholar that when they gained the top of Beechen Cliff, she voluntarily rejected the whole city of Bath as unworthy to make part of a landscape. Which, of course, is funny because you reject reality in favor of artistic and aesthetic beauty. So there's a certain amount of irony in that too. Delighted with her progress and fearful of wearying her with too much wisdom at once, Henry suffered the subject to decline, and by an easy transition from a piece of rocky fragment and the withered oak which he had placed near its summit, to oaks in general, to forest, the enclosure of them, wastelands, crownlands, and government, he shortly found himself arrived at politics, and from politics it was an easy step to silence. Now one of my former professors, Homer Obed Brown, a brilliant and very nice man, spent a great deal of time and attention on this passage because he points out how politics is not an appropriate subject in polite society. And so their movement from the aesthetic realm of the landscape drawing and the picturesque to the enclosure of lands, which of course we know from previous lectures is the government taking away common lands and giving them to landowners, to private landowners, and wastelands, crownlands, and government, he's making the progression into politics. And of course, politics is an inappropriate conversation for a polite discussion with women, though it will come up again in just a moment. So from politics, we go to silence. The general pause which succeeded his short disquisition on the state of the nation was put an end to by Catherine, who, in a rather solemn tone of voice, uttered these words, "I have heard that something very shocking indeed will soon come out in London." And of course, this is a statement that can be read a variety of different ways depending upon one's framework. They've just been talking about politics and the state of the nation, and so something shocking coming out in London at the very end of the 1700s, at a time when there is revolution going on in France and riots going on in London and in manufacturing cities, something shocking coming out in London can have multiple meanings, one of which would be a political uprising or a riot. And Miss Tilney takes it in that way. Miss Tilney, to whom this was chiefly addressed, was startled and hastily replied, "Indeed, of what nature?" "That I do not know, nor who is the author. I have only heard that it is to be more horrible than anything we have met with yet." And author in this sense could mean both the writer and also the creator of the riot. "Good heaven! Where could you hear of such a thing?" "A particular friend of mine had an account of it in a letter from London yesterday. It is to be uncommonly dreadful. I shall expect murder and everything of the kind." "You speak with astonishing composure. But I hope your friend's accounts have been exaggerated. And if such a design is known beforehand, proper measures will undoubtedly be taken by government to prevent its coming into effect." So, of course, Eleanor is thinking this is going to be a riot and the government is going to send out troops. Her brother, Captain Tilney, is one of the troops. And so she is concerned about her brother and she is concerned about, you know, the state of the nation and politics. Henry, of course, is reading this conversation, understanding the disconnection between what Catherine intends and what Eleanor is understanding. "Government," said Henry, endeavoring not to smile, "neither desires nor dares to interfere in such matters. There must be murder, and the government cares not how much." The lady stared. He laughed and added, "Come, shall I make you understand each other, or leave you to puzzle out an explanation as you can?" "No, I will be noble. I will prove myself a man no less by the generosity of my soul than the clearness of my head. I have no patience with such of my sex as disdain to let themselves sometimes down to the comprehension of yours. Perhaps the abilities of women are neither sound nor acute, neither vigorous nor keen. Perhaps they may want observation, discernment, judgment, fire, genius, and wit. Miss Morland, do not mind what he says, but have the goodness to satisfy me as to this dreadful riot."
"Riot? What riot?"
"My dear Eleanor, the riot is only in your brain. The confusion there is scandalous. Miss Morland has been talking of nothing more dreadful than a new publication which is shortly to come out, in 3 duodecimo volumes, 276 pages in each, with a frontispiece to the first of 2 tombstones and a lantern. Do you understand? And you, Miss Morland, my stupid sister, has mistaken all your clearest expressions. You talked of expected horrors in London, and instead of instantly conceiving, as any rational creature would have done, that such words could relate only to a circulating library, she immediately pictured to herself a mob of 3,000 men assembling in St. George's Fields, the bank attacked, the tower threatened, the streets of London flowing with blood,
A detachment of the 12th Light Dragoons, the hopes of the nation, called out from Northampton to quell the insurgents, and the gallant Captain Frederick Tilney, in the moment of charging at the head of the troop, knocked off his horse by a brickbat from an upper window. Forgive her stupidity. The fears of the sister have added to the weakness of women. But she is by no means a simpleton in general. Catherine looked grave. And now, Henry, said Miss Tilney, that you have made us understand each other, you may as well make Miss Morland understand yourself. Unless you mean to have her think you intolerably rude to your sister and a great brute in your opinion of women in general. Miss Morland is not used to your odd ways. I shall be most happy to make her better acquainted with them. Of course, that's sort of a flirtation. I hope that I will get to know her better. No doubt, but that is no explanation of the present, and Eleanor knows exactly what he means. What am I to do? You know what you ought to do. Clear your character handsomely before her. Tell her that you think very highly of the understanding of women. Miss Morland, I think very highly of the understanding of all the women in the world, especially of those, whoever they may be, with whom I happen to be in company. That is not enough. Be more serious. Miss Morland, no one can think more highly of the understanding of women than I do. In my opinion, nature has given them so much that they never find it necessary to use more than half. So in this complex scene, we have a bunch of different things going on. We have gender politics, actual politics, the frameworks of perception that cause misunderstanding and different ways of perceiving the physical world. All of this is very important to understand Catherine's relationship to the world around her. She sees it through a very simple perspective. And in this scene, we're being introduced to a variety of different frameworks, some of them humorous, some of them serious, which show that Catherine needs to learn to understand these various frameworks in order to navigate her world. And in this novel, of course, Eleanor is Catherine's double. A double in literature is an alternative version of a character. Eleanor could be seen to be Catherine as she might be in later years when she is more seasoned and more well-educated and comes to understand these various frameworks that Eleanor seems to navigate, for the most part, fairly well. In the next video, we're going to be looking at the end of the novel as Catherine approaches and arrives at Northanger Abbey and her behavior after she's there. And we're going to be looking at the way Catherine's inability to correctly interpret the circumstances gets her into trouble, both funny trouble and more serious trouble, and how she finally learns to understand the actual circumstances surrounding her and correctly interpret her social and actual situations.